Good evening to those here in the sanctuary, and good evening to those who are watching and viewing with us online. I just want to welcome you to our final night for the week of our Let's Talk About Him series with speaker, Pastor Roy Dennis. I don't know if it's just me, but this series has just been such a blessing, and it has opened a lot of questions, thoughts, topics in my mind, especially as a young person, and I really appreciate that. So before we get into tonight's program, where we will speak on parenting the right way, let us just bow our heads in prayer. Most righteous and eternal Father, we want to give you thanks for today, life, health, and strength, for wisdom, for knowledge, and for understanding. Heavenly Father, I pray that as we're about to go into your program, Lord, I pray that you just be with us. Touch us, Lord, and help us to do your work. Thank you for everything you've done and what you continue to do. In your name I pray, amen. I now invite our praise team as we go into our praise and worship session.
Okay, let's put our voices together as we sing praise and honor to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Welcome to those online. Tune in and feel free to sing with us. The great physician now is near, the sympathizing Jesus. He speaks the drooping heart to share. Oh, hear the voice of Jesus.
Believe. blesseth me. Oh, blessed thoughts, oh, words with heavenly comfort for
and worldwide fame. Gracious to us. He has blessed us in so many ways. And now we are going to give him thanks. I'm going to ask those of us who are in the church to stand while we pray and those online to just have an attitude of prayer. Shall we stand? Our Heavenly Father, it is such a privilege to come into your house of worship. Lord, just to give you thanks and praise for your many blessings on us. You have seen us through the course of the day. You have prevented accidents. You have granted us health and strength. And Lord, we are so grateful. We are also mindful that there are others, Lord, who may not be healthy. We present them before you at this time for you to extend your hand of healing on them. Grant them the strength, Lord, that they stand in need of. We also remember those who have lost loved ones. We ask also, Lord, that you will put your arms of comfort around them and help them to understand, help us all, Lord, that you are always with us despite the circumstances. We thank you for the messages we have been hearing from the week started until now. And we know, Lord, that tonight is not going to be any different. So we ask you to be with the speaker in a very special way. Anoint him, Lord, as you have been doing. And help us, those of us who are listening, that we may reap the blessing. We thank you so much for hearing and for answering our prayers. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Please be seated.
Talk for tonight will be a very important topic. The topic has both current implication and it can also have eternal implication as well. The topic is sleep, rest well. I'll be focusing on what is sleep, sleep wake cycle, sleep phases and stages. Why is sleep important? And tips for a good night's sleep. Also, what are the recommended daily sleep hours? Now, what is sleep? Now, sleep is a period of rest that alternates with wakefulness. Now, our body has a biological need for sleep that increases when you have been awake for a long time. Now, this is controlled by homeostasis. Now, this is the process by which your body keeps your system, for example, your internal body temperature, steady. Now, the hormone adenosine is linked to this need for sleep. While awake, the level of adenosine in your brain continues to rise, signaling a shift toward sleep. Caffeine and certain drugs can interrupt this process by blocking sleep. Now, inside our body, we have internal body clocks. They are called circadian clocks in our body. Now, they control when you are awake and when your body is ready for sleep. Now, these cycles have about a 24-hour rhythm. And it is regulated by numerous factors such as light, darkness, and sleep schedules. Now, once asleep, you cycle through the stages of sleep throughout the night in a predictable pattern. Now, the central circadian clock, this is located in your brain and tells you when it is time for sleep. Now, there are others that are located in organs throughout your body. And as I said before, it follows a 24-hour repeating rhythm. And I make sure I stress this. Now, this rhythm affects every cell, every tissue and organ in your body and how they work. They are in sync with certain cues in the environment, such as light, darkness, sleep schedules. Now, artificial and caffeine can also disrupt this process. Now, your body clock may differ, different from others. Most people's natural circadian cycle is slightly greater than 24 hours. And some people naturally wake up early and some naturally stay. For example, teens prefer later bedtimes and sleep later in the morning than adults. Now, the rhythm and timing of the body clocks decline with age. Why? Neurons are cells in the brain that promotes sleep are lost as part of the natural aging. Now, Alzheimer's disease speeds up the loss of neurons, resulting in harder for older adults to stay asleep. Now, other factors that affect the circadian rhythm are less physical activity or less time spent outdoors. As a result, older adults usually sleep less and wake up earlier. Now, the light signals, when it is received through your eyes, tell your brain that it's daytime. The light-dark cycle influences when the brain makes and releases the hormone called melatonin. Now, the amount of melatonin in your bloodstream starts to rise or increase in the evening, peaks in the early morning, and it is thought that melatonin promotes sleep. Now, as you are exposed to more light, such as sun rising, your body releases another hormone called cortisol. Cortisol naturally prepares your body to wake up. So when you're waking up, your body produces cortisol. Here is a diagram that just gives you the circadian rhythm and shows you how cortisol in the morning peaks and the melatonin decreases about 7:30. Now, exposure to bright artificial lights in the late evening can disrupt this process and prevent your brain from releasing melatonin. So therefore, this makes it harder to fall asleep. Now, examples of some of these bright lights include light from a TV screen, a smartphone, or a very bright alarm clock. Now, some people may use physical filters or software to filter out some of the blue light from these devices. And I'm going to repeat. They are the smartphone, the TV screen, and the bright alarm clock. Now, sleep cycle can also fall out of sync. Now, some people have problems with their sleep cycle, meaning that their brain does not keep them awake or asleep at appropriate times. They may have one of the following sleep disorders: insomnia, having trouble falling asleep, staying asleep, or both. So they get too little sleep or not enough quality sleep. They may not feel refreshed when they wake up. Or they can have narcolepsy, which causes periods of extreme daytime sleepiness. And this disorder can cause muscle weakness. Now, sometimes your central circadian clock is not properly aligned with your sleep time. And this happens when you have one of the following conditions, such as lag, so you have trouble adjusting your sleep to fit a new time zone, or you can have shift work disorder. That happens when people work late at night. Now let us look at the phases and stages of sleep. Now when you sleep, you cycle through two phases of sleep: rapid eye movement and non-rapid eye movement. The cycle starts over every 80 to 100 minutes. Usually you have about 4 to 6 cycles per night. And between cycles, you wake up briefly. Now, sleep studies and sensors record eye movements and brain activity, which are used to classify sleep phases and stages. Now, rapid eye movement, sleep, during this time, the eyes twitch and the brain is active. The brain activity is measured is similar to when you and I are awake, but you are asleep. Now, during this time, dreaming usually happens with your muscles normally limp to prevent you from acting out your dream. Usually you have more of the REM sleep later in the night, but do not have so much of the REM sleep in colder temperatures. Why? Because your body does not regulate its temperature properly. So that is a reason why it's good to sleep with a cover. Here we see a diagram of the sleep cycle, where you have been drowsy, light sleep, moderate sleep, until you go to the deep sleep and then the REM. Now, the sleep phases and stages, it changes as people mature. For example, newborns spend more time in the REM sleep. The slow wave sleep peaks in early childhood, drops sharply in the teenager age, and then it even drops more through adulthood and older people, which then results in them may not have any slow wave sleep at all. Now, sleep plays a very vital role in good health and well-being throughout our life. The way you feel while you are awake, depends in part on what happens while you are sleeping. During sleep, your body is working to support healthy brain functions, maintain your physical health. And in children and teens, sleep helps to support growth and development. I remember when my second son wanted to grow taller, I told him to sleep. When he slept for longer hours, he did grow at a rapid rate. Now, getting inadequate sleep over time can raise your risk for chronic long-term health problems. It can also affect how well you think. It can affect, listen quick, carefully, how well you think, how well you react, how well you work, how well you learn, and how well you get along with others. Here are some of the challenges you can have when you don't sleep properly. When we look at our heart and circulatory system, we see where during the non-REM sleep, our blood pressure and heart rate fall. So the heart does not work as hard as it does when you are awake. And during the REM sleep, when waking, heart rate and blood pressure increase to the levels when you are awake. A sharp increase in blood pressure and heart rate upon waking has been linked to angina. But let me give you some tips for a good night's sleep. Tips for a good night's sleep. Go to bed and wake up at the same time. Try to get at least 30 minutes of sunlight. Exercise regularly.
but not within 2 to 3 hours before bedtime. Avoid caffeine and nicotine. Avoid large meals. I can't stress that no more, anymore. And drinks late at night. And avoid medicines. When you're going to sleep, create a good sleeping environment. You need to have a comfortable mattress and pillow. Keep the room temperature cool. Avoid distractions like noises, bright lights, clocks. But most of all, when you and I practice to sleep properly on a 24-hour basis, we will have a healthy life. But when you and I practice the seventh-day Sabbath, another cycle of rest over a seven-day period, it is proven that Seventh-day Adventists live 7 years longer. And as we practice this in preparation to go to heaven, where we will have Sabbath every 7 days, and at that phase, we will experience eternal life. So let us practice to sleep, rest well and sleep well so that we can have longer life and make it to heaven. Thank you.
If you could own all this world and its money, build castles tall enough to reach the sky above. If you could know everything there was to know life's game, then you've known nothing until you know the love of God. Until you know the loving hand that reaches down to fallen man and lifts him from out of sin, where he has fallen, until you know just how it feels to know that God is really real, then you've known nothing until you've known the love of God. From here to yours.
Good evening, everyone. It is now time to collect the offering for this evening, and I would like to take this opportunity to thank each and every one of you for giving each evening, and this would go towards the funding of the crusade. Will the deacons please come forward? Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we just want to thank you once again for the blessings that you have bestowed upon us, that we can return the gifts that you have given us. May it go to further the gospel, and that people will come to know you as Lord and Savior of their lives. We thank you in thy name. Amen.
Somebody in the house, perhaps somebody online, that you still believe in the power of prayer. See, Psalm 55, 16 and 17 says, evening and at morning and at noon will I pray and cry aloud. And the psalmist says with all confidence that the Lord shall save him, for the Lord shall hear his voice. You see, God's house is a house of prayer. For all, we may come with our burdens, and even if you're online, just want to invite you to pause what it is that you are doing and just lift your heart heavenward. Whatever it is in your life that is in front of you, whatever obstacle that is under your way, just leave it in the hands of Jesus even now. I want to invite those in the congregation, if you feel a special need for prayer this evening, I want you to just make that short journey from your seat to the altar as we lift up our petitions to our God, who not only hears, but to our God who can deliver. And so as we stand and as we are making our way, for we have a need. Lord, I need you to work a miracle. Lord, I need your intervention. Lord, I want for you to touch somebody in my family. Lord, my heart needs transformation. Your miracle working power to be exercised once more. If you believe in the power of prayer, just put your faith in action and be mobile as we come to the altar for prayer. We are humming softly. We are reflecting. We are contemplating. We are talking to our Father in heaven. And every voice is hushed. Every head is bowed. All eyes closed. We are focusing on Jesus even now. Great God, thank you so much for this wonderful opportunity to call upon you in prayer. Lord, we thank you so much that you would have invented this means of communication with you. Lord, already we hear you speaking to us. Lord, we hear you giving us words of comfort and of assurance. Lord, we stand with our feet firmly planted on that text in the prophet Isaiah that says that while we are speaking, you are hearing. And as we are called upon you, you are answering. Lord, we have learned from the word and by life experience that your will is best. Lord, I'm encouraged by Matthew chapter 6 that declares boldly that to you belongs the kingdom, the power, and the glory, not just now, but forever. And so, great God, may you reach down into the deepest recesses of our heart, and Lord, may you wash us. Lord, may you cleanse us. May you look upon our mustard seed of faith and water it by the sweet influence of your Holy Spirit. May this faith not just be one that is put in storage, but one that is alive. May our faith in this moment, Lord, may it shoot and may it root and may it bring forth fruit in our life, Lord. May you do a work within us, and as we come to you with our needs, as your people in your temple have responded to the call, Lord, whatever our needs be, whether they be financial, Lord, whether they are a mental, psychological, or emotional, Lord, we have some deep wounds spiritually that only you can touch. Lord, we are convicted in this moment, for we have turned away from you, the fountain of living waters, and we have hewn out cisterns, broken cisterns, cisterns that leave us empty. Lord, we are saying, let a woman at the well fill us, not just to the brim, but to the overflowing. Lord, bring forth a restoration in our life, where, as it were, we feel as if the locusts of life's afflictions have eaten down all the joy and all the pleasures and all the progress in our life, and that which is left behind is in tatters and ruin. Lord, we are desolate. May you pass through us even in this moment, and just as you cause spring to come after winter, bring a new thing in our life tonight, Lord. May you bring us from the deepest depths of death and plant us on the highest heights of life. Lord, may you turn around our experience. Lord, I know somebody has some needs. The bills are due. Lord, somebody has some needs. The stressors of life are upon them. Oh God, may you turn a situation around. Lord, we cast our eye afar, and we look on our family and our friends online. Lord, there's somebody watching this in a live fashion who needs an intervention from Jesus, who needs liberation from the soul-destroying habits of life. Lord, to put down the liquor, to put away the tobacco, to put away the marijuana. Lord, to put down, great God, the verbal and the emotional and even the domestic abuse. Lord, somebody needs to be brought free from the cycle of violence, great God, from shame and guilt and humiliation. Somebody needs to find freedom, wholeness, and healing in Jesus even now. Lord, we dare to ask that there is somebody who will watch this in a delayed fashion. May your hand reach them even now. Lord, 1 month from now, 6 months from now, 1 year from now, Lord, 6 years from now, let them know that there is a God in Israel who hears our prayers, and you're not limited by time nor by space. But as long as your people need you, O Lord, you will reach down and do that which is needed. Oh, great God, we are more than persuaded. We claim your promise. You have not given us a spirit of fear, but of love, and of power, and of a sound mind. Restore somebody in Jesus. And Lord, may as we arise from our knees, from this our altar of petition, oh Lord, may we be light, for Jesus would have taken our burdens. We claim your promise that all who come unto you that are weary and heavy laden, that Lord, that they will find rest. Take away our burden and give us the yoke of surrender, the yoke of meekness, the yoke of union with Jesus. And may we find joy and peace in him. Thank you that we had needs so we could know that we ought to pray. Thank you for our trials so they remind us that you will give us triumph over them. Thank you for our tests, for you are wrapped in the books and chapters of our testimonies. Thank you, O God, that we can call upon you, and thank you for the miracles. Thank you for your salvation. Thank you for your deliverance. Thank you for doing a new thing. Even now, in Jesus' mighty name we pray, in full confidence, and we say amen and amen.
We thank Pastor Guthrie for the ministry of prayer this evening. Weren't your hearts blessed by this prayer as a petition God on our behalf? Thank you, Pastor Guthrie. We'd also like to thank Sister Guthrie for coming as well, Sister Chantel Guthrie. And we are happy and delighted to have them here with us this evening. This evening also, I'm here to do two things. One, to introduce the speaker. And number two, to give you some gifts. Well, and there is a third one, to remind you of some things to come. And I've been sharing with you and reminding you, and I will begin with number three. Number three, on Sabbath, or on the 13th of April, we will convene our great Singles Connect social right here at the church hall towards the back. We are hoping to see each single here this evening at this social. If you're online and you want to take a drive to Mandeville, please come. This is the place to be. If you are a single person, this is the place to be on the 13th of April at 7 p.m. And then we are hosting our grand marriage recommitment service on the 20th of April right here at SDA Mandeville at 4 p.m. And it gets even better. On the 21st of April, we will host our grand and great prayer breakfast as we pray for our new converts and as we pray for those who are in the valley of decisions. We ask you to be a part of these events as we continue to seek the Lord. Now, there is someone who came here yesterday, and you remember the topic for last evening's presentation by Dr. Dennis. And I have a gift for you. Is there a visitor? You were here last evening and you remember the topic of the presentation? Yes, is there anybody here? You're a visitor and you remember the topic. This is your gift. Going once, going twice, going three times tomorrow, or on Sabbath, I will be here again with gifts. Is there a child? You are a little boy, but you are coming here for the first time. And you say, Pastor, I would like a gift. Is there somebody like this here today? Amen. Come quickly for your gift. Amen. Put your hands together for him. He is brave and bold. All right, this is the word of God, and we ask you to read it as you find Jesus as your Lord and personal Savior. May God continue to bless you. And he has a sister. How can we give the brother a gift and not the sister? I have a gift for you as well. Come right up for it. And this is your own Bible. Put your hands together for her. And may God continue to bless you. And my final task is to introduce the speaker. Listen, yesterday was hot. Last evening was hot. The preacher preached the word. And those who were looking for spouses, they were well edified. And even on Monday, confusion in the bed, we enjoyed this presentation. And this evening, parenting the right way. Someone has been blessing our hearts for these past 2 weeks. He goes by the name of Roy Dennis. Dr. Dennis, for those who do not know, serves as the Family Life Director and the Stewardship Director for the Jamaica Union, one who has been here a number of times and one who has blessed our hearts. Tonight, he is accompanied by his dear wife, Sister Keisha Dennis, and we are always delighted when she is here. And when Sister Dennis is here, he preaches with extra gumption. What do you say? Yes, yes, yes. Let me just say welcome to the viewers on Central Jamaica Conference YouTube platform. I see 217 on online viewers. Let us say welcome to the folks from the Republic of Mike Tongue. We are happy to have you. And those also from Porus, we are also happy to have you. And our regular online members here, may God continue to bless you. Amen.
Vanity and pride, caring with me as we pray. Gracious, loving Heavenly Father, we are grateful once more to be in your presence. We're happy for life. We're happy, Heavenly Father, for the privileges of opening your word again. Your word is divinely written, divinely interpreted. So I pray that you will hide Roy Dennis behind the old rugged cross of Calvary, that you will use him as your instrument once more in the proclamation of your word, that the name of Jesus Christ will be magnified and glorified in this sanctuary and online. Thank you, Lord, for hearing our prayers. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen, amen. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Are you happy to be here tonight? After last night, you're happy to be here. It's good to be in the presence of the Lord. And it's good to be at Let's Talk About Him once more. This evening is a closing night, or the final night for the second week. And my, how time flies. We are closing the second week this coming Sabbath with a big, big, big baptism. Amen. There are many souls who are signing up for the kingdom of God, and we give God praise for that. And so we thank all of you who have been here. Some of you have been here every night, and we are happy for you. There are some persons who are online every night. I heard Pastor mention over 200 just before I came in. There were almost 400 persons online. And we are grateful for your presence from the Central Jamaica Conference platform, from Mike Town, Seventh-day Adventist platform, and from the Porous platform. We welcome you. We welcome our visiting friends in a special way. We are happy to have Pastor and Sister Guthrie and their son. Amen? Amen. And I said, who is that praying? I was online. I said, that person we should allow to get a chance to preach. All right. I don't see Pastor Guthrie, but Sister Guthrie is still here and their son. We are happy to have you. Sister Guthrie is my colleague also at the Union, Associate Youth Director. Thank you for your support. And my niece is here. You will hear from her a little bit later, Nikayla. And also we have Krishan and Haldane from Northern Caribbean University. We are happy to have you with us this evening. In the appeal, you will hear from them. We are happy for the presentation about rest, Sister Peterkin. We really appreciate it. This evening. So when you work, you must do what? You must rest. Amen? You work, you must rest. Let me give you a glimpse of what we are going to get into next week. A glimpse of next week. And my wife is here. She was not here for two nights because I stayed over in Mandeville. But anytime I'm coming from home, my wife is always dressed and ready long before I am. And prepared to come. So I stayed over on Monday night, and then I was here in Mandeville on Tuesday, so she was not here, but she was online. Next week, we have some interesting topics coming up, and we are asking you to continue to be with us. On Sunday night, is this the church? Is this the church? People have questions about the church today. Is there one true church on earth? That's the question we're asking from the prophecy. Then on Monday night, God's financial plan. On Tuesday night, living single. And then so the youth, we are inviting you to come. Living single on Tuesday night, on Wednesday night, divorce-proofing your marriage. And then next week, Sabbath, I mentioned this topic, House of Distress. You can't afford to miss it. So next week, we are stepping up into third gear. It's going to be heavier, and you cannot afford to miss any night next week. We have already prayed, so we are going to get into the message for this evening, Parenting the Right Way. Parenting the Right Way. That's our message for this evening. Growing up on Sundays, in my community, people would have two meals per day. Breakfast late and dinner early. So breakfast would be about 9 o'clock and dinner would be maybe about 2 p.m. But for us as children, when we go to school in the week, we had about 4 meals per day. I was the one who had to go and purchase milk 1 mile away and bring home, and we would get milk and maybe some fried dumplings, and we got the eggs live from the chicken, and we got the milk live from the cows. And so we would get maybe some fried dumplings and eggs and milk for breakfast. And then when we go to school and the bell rings at 10 a.m., that was breaks time. And so it would be breaks time. You would get some cheese chips or maybe a slice of pudding or something. And then at midday, it would be lunchtime. And at the canteen, we used to love the boiled dumpling, cornmeal dumpling, and curry chicken. bulgur and rice. Somebody know about it. You would get some bulgur. Oh, how could I forget that? The bulgur and rice and curry chicken. Man, you'd lick your fingers. But guess what? When we got home in the evening at 3:30 p.m., we would also go home to a hot meal. 4 meals. But on Sunday, it was 2 meals. And for the children, this could be difficult. There was this little boy next door, and he somehow, after he had breakfast and dinner was taking a little long, and when grandma was not in the kitchen, he went inside and he stole a handful of sugar. It seemed to me that grandmothers used to count the sugar grain, because she did not catch him with his hand in the jar, but somehow she knew that some of the sugar was missing. And she took him outside, and she had a belt that she would use on him, and she started beating him mercilessly, and he fell on the ground, and she was beating him still, and he was crying, "Mama, me dead now. Mama, me dead now." She said, "You're not dead yet," and she continued to beat him until he was not moving anymore. And then, like what we would do with a common fall, when you knock down a common fall, you would put a bucket over their head, or you would throw some water on them, and they would get up and run around. You know, she got a bucket of water, and he was still there, and she wet him with the water. And he got up and started to run around. Like a common fall that was knocked down, and that you put a bucket over them and beat over their head. And the question I want to ask you, is that an appropriate measure of discipline for stealing one handful of sugar? That is not an appropriate measure. So tonight we are going to look, and there are some persons who are saying, "All right, if I was not beaten, then I would not be what I am today." But there are others who are saying, I remember one man, when I asked him, "What type of discipline was administered in your family?" He said, "Pastor, I was tied up with rope. I was beaten with machete." There are many children who have been thus beaten. We saw one on the television that was beaten with rope and tied up with rope, and until the laceration marks were on his back, like Jesus, who was lashed 39 times. So let's look at parenting and see some of the principles that we need to bear in mind for effective parenting. A message on the screen. I'm not seeing anything. Parenting the right way. Thank you. So we are looking at parenting, and we are saying that's not an appropriate measure of discipline. So the biggest job in the world is parenting. 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 and a quarter. And a parent will always be a parent. A child will not always be a child. There are parents who want to treat the grown offspring sometimes as children. But they grow up and they later on you know, there's a statement that people use. They said he has three adult children. Is that correct? Three adult children. They are either adults or they are children. They are offsprings or progenies. So they are three adult offsprings. But so I'm saying that you can say what you may, but sometimes it's not a matter of speaking, but it's a matter of how the parents respond to their children. And the role of the parents is to prepare the children, to move them from independence now to dependence, rather to independence. It is your role to help them to fly out of the nest. And when you do that, you are satisfied. I listened to a man who spoke about his children that he trained, and he spoke about how these children had grown and how they had gotten married, all three of them, and how they were still in the church and how they were doing well professionally. And when I looked at his face, it seemed to me that if he died then, he would be satisfied that his work on earth would have been accomplished. It is a wonderful experience when you prepare your children and they are doing well. But sometimes, as you try to prepare your children, they can give you grief. So we are looking at some key principles for successfully training your children. Come with me to 1 Samuel chapter 1, 11 and 28, our first text tonight. 1 Samuel chapter 1 and verses 11 and 28. The Bible says here, 1 Samuel chapter 1 and verse 11 and 28. And she vowed a vow and said unto the Lord of hosts, if thou wilt indeed look on the affliction of thine handmaid and remember me, and not forget thine handmaid, but wilt give unto thine handmaid a man-child, I will give him unto the Lord. I will give him to whom? Unto the Lord, all the days of his life, and there shall no razor come upon his head. That was before the fact. But now after the fact, as the Lord blessed her, verse 28, the Bible says, therefore also, this is the same Hannah speaking, have I lent him to the Lord. As long as he liveth, he shall be lent to the Lord. And she worshipped there. And she worshipped the Lord there. So the story is that Elkanah had two wives, Hannah and Penina. And any man who has two wives is bound to have frustration. We saw when Abraham left Sarah and went into Hagar. Even now in the Middle East, there is division and fighting because of that one situation. We saw other situations in the scripture where men had two wives and there was competition and grief in the home. I remember there was one man who had a wife, and he couldn't marry two wives in Jamaica, but he also had another woman, and the wife knew about that woman, and the woman knew about that wife. And I thought that this man, not easy. But when the man started telling his story, he started to cry. Because the wife and the woman were in competition, and none of them would leave him. So that was creating frustration. Competition for the money, competition for the time, competition for the intimacy, competition, and he could not keep up with this. So Elkanah had two wives, and the one that would have children was Penina, but Hannah could not have children. So he had to give attention more to Penina. And that year, that we are dealing with here, they would go up to Shiloh, and when they go up there, then the family, I imagine, would travel along and that for that one period, and they would go up there, and because Penina had the children, she would be the one to get the attention. So when they were going back home, Hannah stayed, and she agonized, and she prayed to God. As a matter of fact, she said to her husband before that, give me child or I die. That's how much she wanted a child. And she prayed and she agonized. And as she was weeping and crying, the priest Eli came in and he saw her agonizing and he thought she was drunk. Woman, he says, why don't you stop drinking? My paraphrase now. She says, I'm not drunk, but I'm agonizing for the Lord to bless me with a child. She said, if you bless me with a child, I will give him to you all the days of his life. How many days? All the days of his life. I will return him to you. And Eli the priest says, because of your prayer, because of your faith, God is going to bless you. And so by the following year, when they were going up to Shiloh, Hannah could not go. And the reason she could not go is that she had a child. She named him Samuel. And you know about Samuel. She had made a promise that she would return him to the Lord. And when he was of the age, when she weaned him, she brought him into the service of the temple. And she says, Lord, I am returning him to you as I have promised. This is significant. Three things that we learn from Hannah's story. That the children come from God. The children come from who? From God. Jesus says, if you hurt any one of these little children, it's better a millstone be placed around your neck and you'll be cast in the sea. You know what the millstone is? The millstone is a heavy thing like an anchor that you use for the ship. When that is tied around your neck and they sink you with that, you can't come up from sea. So Jesus says, don't hurt these little ones. It's better a millstone be placed around your neck. Children are from God. Children are for God. And children are to be returned to God. There are parents who are preparing the children for profession and for success in this life, but they are not preparing them for heaven. Parents need to prepare their children for heaven. Come on, say amen. And I want to use this to make an appeal, because next week Sabbath, we are going to have a big baptism with all the children who are not yet baptized, but they are of the age for baptism. No one needs to come into your home to prepare your children. No Bible worker had to come into my home. My wife and I, from the children before they were born, we are singing for them. We are reading to them. We are preparing them. And long before they were seven, when we believe that the brain is developed to the point that they can choose between right and wrong, they are already asking for baptism. So parents, you need to prepare your children. Don't wait on anybody to come when they are 12 and 14 and 15. Then you as the parents are going to say they are not ready. I remember I was in a campaign many years ago and we were out and we were doing Bible study and we were baptizing children, 7 and 8 and 10. And there was a grandchild of the Bible instructor who requested baptism and the Bible instructor said he's not ready yet. So right in her home, she had somebody that she should be working with, but she was winning other souls for the kingdom of God. I said, let me study with him. I studied with him, but she claimed that he had too much faults. This is someone who grew up in the church, who was running around in the church, and had her support as a family member going to church on a weekly basis. Later on in life, that same Bible worker called me to say, come and see if you can work with my grandson, because now I want him to get baptized and he does not want to get baptized. And he was frank when he said, when I wanted to get baptized, you said no. Don't worry about the keeping. You do the preparation. You continue to work with them. And Jesus is able to keep them. Are you with me? And sometimes after they baptize, some may falter along the way. But God is able to bring them back. What do you say? But don't prevent the children from giving their hearts to the Lord. They are from the Lord. They are for the Lord. They are to be returned to the Lord. True education is not just pursuing a particular course of study. It has to do with mental development, but it also has to do with spiritual development. Are you with me? And preparation for the kingdom of God. this is another point I want to make here. When your children are doing CSEC exam, when they are doing PEP exam, don't pull them out of the church choir. Don't pull them out of the Pathfinder. Teach them to multitask. Yes, they'll have to manage their time, but they are better off when they continue to do these things, because when you pull them from Bible class, pull them from AY, pull them from the things of church, they think that schoolwork is important, but church is not. And I am saying this, I have studied at every level of the ladder, and growing up in my home church, we had to walk 1 mile to church at Tollgate from where I live in the morning for 9 a.m. We had to walk 1 mile back home for lunch. We had to walk 1 mile back 2:30 p.m. for choir practice. If you go to Tollgate Church, everybody sing on the church choir. The church choir is almost as big as the church. Young children, young people, we had to walk back every Sabbath for choir practice. And we stayed for Bible class. And sometimes we walk back home and then we come back for social in the night. We are walking about 8 to 10 miles every Sabbath. And we are in Pathfinder and we are doing these things. And I went to high school, primary school and high school. And even at university, I never stopped doing what I'm doing for the Lord for any degree. Not at all. And I'm saying to you, make sure that you encourage your children to keep their connection with God at every stage of the game. They belong to God. They must be returned to God. So, how are good parents made? Are they born? Or is it because of preparation? You born good parents? No. None of us are born good parents. We have to be prepared. Can the children learn as we work with them? There was a minister of government who had a statement, every child can learn, every child must learn. Do you believe every child can learn? Yes, every child can learn. But there are some children who may not learn at the level of the general population. Because there might be deficiency at birth and there might be developmental disorder that affect the children and they might not be able. And sometimes we try to force these children with developmental disorder and learning disability in the same class with the ones who are running with the normal group, and some parents deny that these children have a problem. So we need to look out for some challenges when they are developing. And if you find that they are not talking as early as the normal population, and if you find that they are mixing up some things and so on, and if you find that they are not socially adjusted, then it would be worth it to have some assessment done, to talk with your counselor. It's better to do it and everything is all right. Because I've had parents come to me, and I remember one mother brought a child to me and saying that the child is not talking. And so she thinks that the child needs to be assessed. And before the child left my office, the child was saying a word or two. Because I spoke with the child and I asked them their name. And the child was trying to pronounce something. And I told them how to pronounce it. And I spent the time. And I realized that the child was not talking because nobody was talking with the child. So it was not a developmental disorder. It was the fact. So it's better to go and to find out that nothing is wrong than not to go and wait until it is bad. So there are two principles I want to give you tonight for effective parenting. If you forget everything, these are the two principles: love and discipline. What are the two words? Love and discipline. So we focus first on love. What the Bible says about love in Colossians chapter 3, verse 14. Put on love. Put on what? Which binds them together in perfect unity. Put on love. So the balance of love and discipline will determine what type of parent you are. The authoritarian parent, strong on discipline, low on love. Strong on law, strong on rules. There are some parents, they want the children to obey. They will discipline the child if the child does not obey, but they will never say, I love you. Parents need to show the children that you love them, and you need to tell them that you love them. And sometimes the children are giving trouble, but should you love them still? Yes. Listen, one of the things I was excited about when I look in the there are some rights by the children's services in Jamaica, and they said the child has a right to their meals, the child has a right to health care, the child has a right to education, but they also say the child has a right to love, to be loved. So that is not a privilege, that's a right. You must love your children. Amen. Permissive parents, strong on love, low on discipline. There are some parents who love so much that they can't discipline. You may have heard the story of the son who the mother loved so much she wouldn't discipline him. He got into trouble and went to court. And when he went to court, he was sentenced. While he was about to go to prison, he said, "I want to say something to my mother first." And when they brought him to his mother, he bit off her ears. Because he blamed her for not disciplining him. Don't let your children bite off your ears. So if you love and you don't discipline, you would create spoiled child. And I see even some adults who are spoiled. Don't you see it in the media? Even some political leaders in the media, when they don't get what they want, they throw a tantrum. You see that anywhere? Spoiled child. Get all they want, allowed to eat anything they want, throw a tantrum when they don't get away. Not corrected when they are disrespectful, and they will fight and display warlike behavior. They will not be given moral or spiritual guidance. So when you have family worship, you say, "Let the child sleep." Listen. Family worship, you should invite the children. They should be there. They should know that they should be a part of it. Family worship should be geared, if you have children, towards the children, not towards the adults. You spend a lot of time, 1 hour, 2 hours in your personal devotion, but if you have children, you don't need to spend more than 10 or 15 minutes. I know of many Adventist offsprings who have left the church because some parents do overdo it with family worship. I remember a particular person who would spend 3 hours reading out all of Ellen White books every morning, and basically all the children are out of the church today. As a matter of fact, some of them grow to hate her because they think that it was Ellen White that was punishing them. Use the children's Bible story. Use the 28 fundamentals for children. Use the children's lesson that they can understand. And if you use something like the adult devotional, discuss it and explain so that the children will understand. So family worship, when you have children, should be geared towards the children. And so the children should be a part of it. The children are not deprived of watching what they want. Listen, some children are allowed to eat what they want, watch what they want, go where they want, do what they want. Sometimes you wonder who is in charge in the house. And you know, this is why in the United States, there are some persons when they reach 30, or even by they reach 15 or 20, they are 300 or 500 pounds. And even though they have operation to cut the stomach, because nobody taught them to control their appetite. Food is available. Eat what you want, when you want, any amount that you want. And so by the time they don't learn to discipline themselves, they are overweight. There's a relative of mine who works at one of these hospitals that cuts the stomach and make it smaller in order to get people to lose weight. And she told a story of one person who stayed inside and ate so much food that they were bigger than the door. So when she was sick inside and they wanted to get her out, they had to knock out the wall. Lacking self-control, the parental discipline will lead to self-discipline. Then there is the neglectful parents. These persons, they are not strong on rules and they are not strong on love. There are some children growing themselves. The parents don't show love, and the parents don't discipline. And this is the one that we would prefer. There are times when you have to exercise authority, and you will have to give specific command. The authoritative parent is strong on rules and strong on love. So, the authoritative parent have an open, loving relationship with the child. Allows the parent and the child to be friends. Now, when we say the parent and the child to be friends, we are not talking about doing the children's stuff and not having order and respect. One mother wanted to be friends with her teenage daughter. She wanted to dress in tight jeans like the teenage daughter. She wanted to go to everywhere that the teenage daughter going. And the teenage daughter had to say, "Mommy, I want you to be there for me, but I don't want you to go everywhere I'm going." So being friends means that you're available, that you will listen to them. Rules must be clearly defined and conformity must be required. Parents are firm and loving, and when discipline is necessary, it must be administered in love. Can you administer discipline in love? Yes. Discipline can be administered in love. So we are talking now about love. The focus is on love here. We're going to move to discipline for the next half of the message tonight. So this is how we tie up this portion on love now. There are five love languages that we are told by one author that we can utilize to demonstrate our love to our children. Physical touch. Your children want to be touched. Sometimes you see your children coming close to you. Some parents run them away, say, "Move from here." When your children snuggling up. Oh, I see one of them snuggling up with my wife there. When your children snuggling up, don't run them away. Don't run them away, but love them. Let them feel at home. Let them feel appreciated. Physical touch. But you need to teach your children good touch from bad touch. As very early, you need to teach them that if somebody touch them in a particular place, that they need to tell their parents about it. Physical touch. Words of affirmation. Do you tell your children when they have done well that you are proud of them? Quality time. And listen, the more children you have is the more time you need. So I have 3 children, so I need time for myself. I need time for myself and Jesus. I need time for myself and my wife. I need time for myself and my wife and all the children. I need time for myself and each of the children by themselves. So it's a lot of time. The more children you have, is a lot more time you need. And the children like their personal time. I remember I was driving to Kingston and one of my children said, "I want to come with you, Daddy." And he strike up a conversation. He says, "Daddy, tell me about some of the big things that happened in the world since I was born." And I told him about the world recession and how banks crashed and how, you know, we had to readjust our finances in the home in order to survive. And we had that conversation from Old Harbor to Kingston, and we had that conversation to come back home. And when he reached home, he thanked me for taking him. Children want their parents to spend time with them. Quality time. Gifts of appreciation. Our children love gifts? Yes, the children want us to give them gifts. And it doesn't have to be expensive. And I find now that we normally practice giving our children gifts when they do well at school. So they plan to do well and they plan what gift they want. Sometimes the gifts are so expensive we can't afford it. So you know what I do? Sometimes I have to draw on grandma and grandpa. Because what are they here for? So gifts of appreciation and acts of service. You must do things for your children. That's how you demonstrate your love. Let's move to discipline. Child discipline is to set rules that are necessary measures to increase desirable behavior and to decrease undesirable behavior, which ultimately creates self-control. So discipline is to decrease the undesirable and to do what? Increase the what? The desirable. Decrease the undesirable and increase the desirable. So, discipline is different from punishment. Discipline is different from punishment. And so this is what you need to know now. Discipline is correcting in righteousness. Punishment is to hurt. So you could do the same thing, and the thing that you do is discipline, and on another occasion it is punishment. The idea is that anytime you are disciplining, it must be to help and not to hurt. If you're doing it to show that you are the mother or you are the father, or to show that, to you know, we used to hear this term, to show you a sauce. You don't know that one. To show the person, rather than to guide them on the right path, then it is punishment. Discipline is done in love. Punishment is done in anger. When you're angry, you could kill the child. Discipline is done to establish relationship. Punishment exercise control. You know, in relationship, sometimes there are people who want to exercise control. I want to control you. Listen, God, we have to lead our children from dependence to independence. If you control them all their lives, they won't become independent. So some people want to control. I want to move this also to the marriage. That husband and wife, what you need is relationship. There are some persons who have a challenge when it says the man is the head of the house. That's what the Bible says. But some men have a problem with that, and some women have a problem with that. And the reason is that in the home, you don't establish relationship. The man uses the term headship to lord it over the woman. But Pastor Martin Barrow says the man is the head, but the woman is the heart. These are two vital organs for life. And so you can't survive without the head and the heart, the brain and the heart. This is because the man is expected to be the more rational, and the woman is more emotional and more sensitive of the two. So you need the head and the heart. You need the head and the heart. Tell your neighbor you need the head and the heart. You need the head and the heart. Listen, the head gives instruction and said to the heart, pump blood all over the body. And the heart sends blood to the brain so that it can survive to give instruction. Now, if the head is upset with the heart and says, I am not giving the heart any more instruction, what is going to happen to the head? The head is going to die. And if the heart is upset with the head and says, listen, I'm not going to give any more blood to the head because I'm upset with the head, what is going to happen to the heart? This is another question I want to ask you. When is a person dead? When the heart is dead or when the brain is dead? When the heart is dead. And when the brain is dead? When the brain is dead, are you dead? If your brain is dead, are you dead? So some persons, their brains are dead, but their heart is working. What will the doctor do? Pronounce you dead? No. They'd say your brain dead, but you're not dead, because they are hoping that you will be revived. So they're going to put you on a machine and keep you functioning and hope that your brain will come back alive. No, if the heart is dead, are you dead? And your brain alive? Yeah. So the doctor will not pronounce you dead until the brain and the heart is dead. Both of them have to be dead to be pronounced dead. You can have a heart transplant and you can go on life support, but the brain and the heart is dead. And I want to say this to say, listen, we don't need to quarrel about who is head and who is the heart. We just need to have relationship. Are you with me? You need to have relationship. And a lot of men like to ask the question, who must have the final decision? The final decision on some things. I've shared with you that my wife is a teacher. So when it comes to education, I don't believe I should have the final decision on education. We discuss and I give my reasoning. When it comes on religious things, I am a pastor. That's my training. Are you with me? The final decision. When it comes on purchasing a car, which is a technical skill, and my wife is not technical. I never seen her fix anything yet, but she baked pumpkin cake, but she never fix anything. I've never seen her fix anything. So the technical skills is mine. She fix dish. She fix a dish. So based on our skills and expertise, we make decisions together. Discipline enhances self-esteem. Punishment destroys self-esteem. Discipline establishes understanding. Children need to know why you discipline them so they don't do it again. So the first thing is that you need to have rules. And if they break the rules, you discipline them. If you have a situation where they did something and the rules were not there, should you discipline them? No. Well, the only discipline is that you're going to talk with them to let them know that they should not do that again. All right? Often we talk about the rod of correction. So somebody says, if the thing is that we use the rod to teach rather than to correct. So the child should be aware why they are disciplined, and in punishment, sometimes the child don't know. A lot of persons who were beaten in the past will tell you that sometimes I get some licks and I don't even know why my parents was beating me. And the truth is, sometimes the man left the wife and she just upset with him and she can't catch him and he killed the children with licks all the time. And sometimes the wife gone left the man and he can't catch the wife and he killed the children with licks all the time. They take it out on the children. And that is not fair to the children. So these are some disciplinary measures. Corporal punishment. This is the one that is being debated today. Whether or not to use the strap. Whether or not to use the strap. It says punishment and we say you should discipline. But can the strap be used to discipline? Well, some persons will get into the Bible. I will give you two statements that has assisted me on how I relate to this. Because there are different measures that you have to use. With they say seven different brothers, seven different minds. And no one method will work for every child. So the first thing I will say is that Ellen White says, and you know we believe in our writings and we often refer to them. Ellen White says that this should be last resort. In other words, that if everything else fails, then that's when the strap may come into play. It should be last resort. But also, Dr. James Dobson, you know of him on Focus on the Family. I listened to him some time ago. And he says, listen, if the parent is going to use this method, he should use the soft part of his body and the soft part of the child's body. So you're talking about like the hand middle and the buttocks. And the reason he says this is that both the parent and the child will feel it. Because that is what discipline is about. And one my thing now, what I want to put in, is that the older the child, if you are using this method, the older the child get, is the harder you will have to hit them. So after a while, it's going to become abuse. Am I right? You have to go hit them harder, especially if you have to relate to a teenager and you have to use the strap or so on. You have to hit them harder. And more times. So if it can, this should be last resort. So young children, time out. Now this is what is said about time out. You know what time out is? You put them in a well, naughty corner is a different one, but it's similar to naughty corner. You put them in a spot, maybe in their room or a corner, and you give them some time by themselves. What the family life practitioner says is that when you put them in timeout, it must be their age plus 1 minute. Their age, they hold their ears on their foot. The right ear and the left foot. And they are in the nautical timeout. When it's timeout, it must be their age plus 1 minute. So if the child is 2, how long they should go in timeout? 3 minutes. And when you are finished with them, for the 3 minutes, you bring them back to the family. Because what happens is that some parents put them, isolate them, and never bring them back to the family, and they get isolated from the family, and they drift away from the family. So, time out. Time out. Their age plus 1 minute. But because we want to punish them, we keep them there for 1 hour and 2 hours until they start crying and begging for mercy, because we want them to suffer and we want them to know that I am the parent here. Grounding. Grounding for the older ones, little bit older ones now, is when you say, all right, you're not going to go out for particular things that they would like to go out to. And then there is scolding. Some people may look at scolding as spanking. We look at corporal punishment already, but scolding is defined here as the parent talking and the child not getting the opportunity to respond. So you are giving them particular instruction, but you're not allowing them to respond. And I find myself do that sometimes. That's not the ideal one. So you just talk, you just tell them, to what you're going to do with yourself if you don't do this? What is going to happen to you? You want your life to go down the drain. You alone talking, but you're instructing the child. That's scolding. But there's another one called reasoning. Reasoning, sit down and non-punitive there, number three, as compared to scolding. Reasoning now is when you allow the child to respond. So you're talking, and this is for the older ones though, you're talking with the child and you're going to say, all right, if you want to be a doctor and you don't do your homework, do you think that you will become a doctor? And you allow the child to respond. What do you think the child is going to say? Say, no, I don't think I can become a doctor without doing my homework. So how do you get to become a doctor? The child might say, I need to do my homework. So they are making the decisions and they are finding the solutions in the situation. And they own the decisions. Praise and reward. This is positive reinforcement. That when they do something right, you reinforce that. When they do something wrong, you don't give that attention. So this is what happens when the little boy goes out in the street and starts to dance to the reggae music. What the people do is that they give him positive reinforcement. They say, look at him. They say, whoa, and they laugh and they give attention. What do you think he's going to do again? He's going to do that. No, he goes out there and he dances and you are talking with someone. You don't pay him any mind. You don't punish him, you don't do, and you don't pay him any mind. He does it again, you don't pay him any mind. You may talk to him about it and say you should not do that. So you don't give him any attention. But now he's kind to his sister. And he shares his mango with his sister. And you give that attention. So you focus on the positive and you starve the negative. Natural consequences as they get older. Listen, there are some fight that you must not take up with your teenagers. That sometime you may have to allow them to lose their cell phone. You talk to them about how to do certain things and you know they're going to lose it if they continue. But they continue to do it and you allow them to lose it. And then no, they're going to do without it for a while. Natural consequences. Now, you're not going to allow them to fail their exam. So you have to choose carefully what you do. And then now, there is the WW and RR principle. This last one I want to share here. WW by Martin Barrow. WW means when they do wrong. W for wrong, you withhold. When they reward. When they do right, you reward them. RR for reward when they are right, WW for withholding when they are wrong. Withhold when wrong. Now, this is what I want to say. You don't withhold rights. You withhold privileges. Sorry, you don't withhold rights, you withhold privileges. You don't withhold needs, you withhold wants. So do you withhold the child's meal, their food, their dinner? No. Don't be, I was in the barber shop and a lady walked in and they were talking about disobedient children. And she said, listen, you can talk about disobedient children. She said, my children, like she said, I have 5 children and none of them can be disobedient to me. And they said, what do you do? She said, listen, when they are disobedient to me, I put them on 2 days fasting. So the children, they know if they are disobedient, hunger going to kill them for 2 days. The Jamaican law says you must not withhold the children's meals. They have a right to their dinner and their breakfast. They don't have a right to ice cream, so you can withhold ice cream on Sunday. But you don't withhold food. You don't withhold health care. Let your children, the children should be immunized. You don't withhold school. You don't stop them from school because they misbehave. So you withhold wants and not needs. So I will close off with 10 commandments for parenting teenagers. This is where it gets difficult. 10 commandments, quickly. Number one, commandment number one. Lead them from dependence to independence. You're leading them from what? Dependence to independence. When the child is seven and they are going to school, you might say, when you get home in the evening, you must do your homework, you must take a bath, you must eat your dinner, and then you can get to, they don't watch TV nowadays, so you get to go on the tablet. So you give them the order as a little child. Now, by the time they are 10 and 12, you should not have to be doing that. They know that they should come and they should have a bath and they should eat their dinner and they have some time to go on the tablet. Listen, you don't have to give them that order. Now you give them more latitude that they can do what they, you know, they will spend the time and you just monitor to ensure that homework is done and so on and their bath is taken and so on. If you have to be instructing now your offspring at 12 in the same order and you have to be every day, you have to be telling them the order to follow, at that age you have a problem. So as they get older, you're giving them more latitude. And one of the things that we practice, we give our children, we save. We have a saving account and we start from there early. But by the time they reach a particular age, we give them the bank card. What do you think they're going to do with the bank card when they just get it? Empty the money. That's the first thing. So they know now that if you just spend money, it will what? It will finish. So now you're teaching them that they have to put in money in order to get money out. And you start teaching them money management. So you're leading them from dependence to independence. Lead them to God. Thou shalt help the teenagers to have their spiritual identity. Your teenagers are going to ask you questions that they never asked you when they were a little child. So they are going to come to you and ask you some questions. And recently, my middle son asked me a very important question. And I can use this one. And he said, what does it mean, Daddy, to rise, Peter, kill, and eat? In the back of my mind, the first thing that came to mind is that I have preached on this. I know he must have heard on this, about this more than once. So what is he asking now? But I didn't ask him that. In my head. That was only in my head. But I said, I'm happy you asked the question. Because no, the first thing I saw is that he was interested in a Bible discussion. So I didn't chide him as a Seventh-day Adventist. I said, you should have known that because you grew up in the church. I said, why are you asking? He said, Daddy, there's a discussion in a WhatsApp group with my friends. And I said, all right, I'm going to teach you something about biblical interpretation. Number one, you don't take a verse in the middle of a chapter and make a doctrine out of that. That's number one. Rise, Peter, kill, and eat. So you have to start from the beginning of the chapter and then you go to the end of the chapter. I said, start at the beginning of the chapter and tell me what you see. And what he saw in the beginning of the chapter is that God had spoken to a man by the name of Cornelius and said, go to Peter. And God had spoken to Peter and said, go to Cornelius. So this was not a matter of eating and drinking. This was a matter of evangelism. The context of the text. The second thing I said, take that chapter now in the context of the scripture, of the Bible. What does the Bible say about unclean food? And so the context of the scripture is that you must not eat unclean food. So I said, if this text is saying eat unclean food, it would be contrary to the context of the scripture. And then we also say that the Bible interprets itself. So I took him to the verse now later on in the chapter that says, God has shown me that I should not call any what? Any man common or unclean. So was it talking about food or human beings? It was talking about evangelism in the context of the text. And it was talking not only, it was not talking about food, it was talking about human beings. So this was the gospel to the Gentiles. And I had a conversation with my son. So when they ask the difficult questions, help them to understand. And if you don't understand, seek help from maybe your pastor or someone else. And if you can't answer, be truthful to them. So, number three, commandment number three. Thou shalt identify with the interests of your teenagers. What are the interests of your teenagers? Well, I have two sons, they kick football. So I have to identify with that. And I used to kick football with the young men in the community. But as I get older, and I don't think my bones set so easily again, and they're kicking me up too hard, Pastor Brown. When I go on the football field, the guy's kicking me machine, man. So I don't. But I will play football with my sons. Take on a juggling match and so on. Identify with the interests. But they watch what they listen to. Right? Number four, spend time with them. Remember to spend quality time. We talk about that already, that your children need quality time. And especially the teenagers, you will lose them if you don't spend time with them. Number five, thou shalt maintain open communication with your teenagers. Pick a conversation with them. Find opportunity. I was watching something where the parents, they were buying a house, and they said they bought the house 1 mile away from the child's school, that they will walk with the child to school so that they can have conversation. Make opportunity to have conversation with your teenagers. Discipline them. So teenagers believe that they are too big to be disciplined sometimes. But we mentioned that discipline and punishment is not one and the same. So discipline them if you have to. Now, there are some things that I said you must leave to consequences when it comes to the teenagers. That you don't need to put yourself in any fight because it's going to work out itself. It's going to prove to them that if you do this, if you keep drawing money out of your bank account, it's going to be empty. So you don't need to be after them day after day, every day, every day. Say, don't draw out the money. And you learn from that. So those things, but there are some, now if their life is at stake, you don't do that. So use consequences. And listen to this. Pick your battles. Deal with the crucial and ignore the casual. Sometimes your teenagers come and you know it's a fight they come to pick with you this evening. Something happened at school. Something happened out there. And you want to give them some instruction. And you know it's a fight. So you just leave it for a little while. Until they are willing to, ready to talk. So there are some battles that you don't bother to take on. Talk to your teenagers about sex. Now we talk about the little ones, about good touch and bad touch. But the teenagers now, you have to talk to them about sexual intimacy. And what that means. And if you get involved, and we say that sex is for marriage, male and female. And we need to talk to them now and say, if you get involved sexually, then you can get pregnant or you can get sexual transmitted infection. That will be a life sentence. You say HIV is not a death sentence. It is a life sentence. And I want to say that there are some people will tell you that if you're a virgin, you can cure their disease. That's a lie. There are some persons, teenagers, who get involved sexually, and the first time they get involved, they catch a disease that will give them cancer and a disease that will be in them for life. Some of these teenagers, they had sex with an older person one time, and some of them find it that they have to live single because they have a disease that they might find it difficult to get married. like HIV. And also pregnancy, there are some people think that if they are virgins, they can't get pregnant. So don't allow anybody to trick you. God expects young people to maintain their sexual integrity. So you have to teach the young people. And listen, even though the world is saying everybody is doing it, sex before marriage is a predictor of failure in marriage. So teach your children to keep their integrity. The more persons you are exposed to before you get married, the more you can compare your marriage partner, and the more difficult it will be for you to adjust and to maintain a marriage relationship. And you must also teach your children that marriage is good, marriage is honorable, and the bed is undefiled. Because if our young people don't get married and don't have children, a lot of people now don't want to have any children, the species will die off in the next generation. Japan is importing over 500,000 young people now because it's an aging population. The Prime Minister of Jamaica begging married people in Jamaica to have more children because our population is not growing. There are many populations in Europe that are dying. I watched one on BBC just last week of this community that is dying out, literally dying out. And the woman now calling her friend, two of them are in their 70s, and she calling her friend and she said, we are the two last ones left. And they are saying when those people die out, then that community will not exist anymore. So we have to teach our children about being responsible and about life in the future, sexual intimacy, and about marriage. Love your child. Thou shalt love thy teenager unconditionally. Love them how? Unconditionally. You know, some of the children will give you a problem, you know. But you must love them anyhow. I watched as I had to just jump in, even though it was not my business, as a woman was following her son one day with a pot of hot water to throw it on him. And the son, a machete, saying, if you throw that on me, I'm going to chop you up today. And she was calling him a homosexual and he was calling her a prostitute. And when I intervened, I realized that she stopped sending him to school because he was giving trouble. And I had to say to her, I said, mother, if you had sent him to school today, it would have been better off for you. Because if you sent him to school today, you wouldn't have that quarrel now. And if you she says she wants him out of the house. If you send him to school, he will be equipped to come out of the house. But if you don't send him to school, you're going to have him here with you longer. So send him to school. She was saying how she doesn't love him and she wants him to die. My brothers and sisters, there are parents like that. I remember a mother, when her son was killed by the police, she said, I'm glad he's dead. Because he's giving me grief, bad company. There are some children who will give you grief, but we must love them anyhow. Flesh of our flesh and bone of our bone. And we must not stop praying for them. Number 9, when you experience disappointment, get up and move forward. And finally, the Bible says, pray without ceasing. Pray without what? Pray without ceasing. So when you have done your best, God will make up for the rest. So we close with this, our final text, Deuteronomy 6, verses 6 to 9. Come with me to Deuteronomy chapter 6 and verses 6 to 9. The Bible says, and these words which I have commanded thee this day shall be in thy heart, and thou shalt teach them diligently. Teach them how? Unto thy children, and thou shalt talk of them when thou sittest in thine house, and when thou walkest by the way, and when thou liest down, and when thou risest up. And thou shalt bind them for a sign upon thine hand, and they shall be as frontlets between thine eyes. And thou shalt write them upon the post of thy house and on thy gates. So the Bible says here that we must have the commandments of God in our hearts. Number one. Number two, that we must share the commandments with our children. And number three, we must model the commandments. We must live them out in our daily lives. So we want our children to be obedient. Amen, parents? And the Bible says to the children, children, obey your parents in the what? In the Lord, for this is what? Right, honor your father and your mother, that your days may be what? Long. But I'm saying to you as we close tonight that all of us are God's children. And God wants all of us, like every parent wants their children to be obedient. God wants us to be obedient to his commandment. He says we must have his commandment in our hearts and we must teach them to our children. We must first have them in our hearts. The Bible makes it clear that God's commandments must be kept. The rich young ruler went to Jesus and said, what shall I do to be saved? What did Jesus say? Jesus says, keep my commandments. And Jesus made it clear, these things you must do. He said, which commandment? Jesus pointed to the 10 commandments. And I'm saying tonight that the commandments are still to be kept. What do you say? But man says that God's commandments are done away with. But what did Jesus say in Matthew chapter 5 verse 18? Matthew 5 verse 18. We're still closing. Matthew 5 and verse 18. Man says God's commandments are done away with. But Jesus says in Matthew 5 and verse 18 that though, Matthew 5 and verse 18 rather, it says here, for verily I say unto you, till heaven and earth pass away, one jot or tittle shall in no wise pass from my law until all be fulfilled. And then there's a twin text in John 14 verse 15 and John 15 verse 14. John 14, 15 and 15, 14. It says, if you love me, keep my commandments. If you love me, do what? And John 15, 14. Ye are my friends if ye do whatever I command you. God wants all of us, parents and children alike, to be his obedient children, to keep his commandment, to live by his standards and principles, and to prepare for his soon and imminent return so that we can be saved by his grace. What do you say? Is it your desire by the grace of God tonight to be one of God's commandment-keeping children, to be faithful to his law, to be obedient to him like a child is obedient to the parent, because you want to be a part of his glorious kingdom? Will you raise your hand? Amen. We're going to invite Nikayla to come at this time as we take a special song.
Faithful Father, enduring friend, your tender mercies like a river with no end, it overwhelms me. Stand in wonder once again. Your grace still amazes me. Your love still a mystery each day. I fall on my knees Savior. You make me whole. You are the author and the healer of my soul. What can I give you? Lord, what can I say? I know there's no way to repay you, only to
grateful for God's amazing grace. We have not been all that we should have been. We have not always been obedient to God's will, but thank God for His grace and mercy. What do you say? And so we give Him praise tonight. Parents, receive His grace. Children, receive His grace as we prepare for His soon and imminent return. I'm going to invite you to stand as we close with prayer. I invite you to bow your heads with me. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the word tonight. Very important reminder on principles of parenting, love, discipline. I pray that the message will be accepted, the principle will be applied in the home and in the family for effect between parent and child. In a special way, the appeal has been made for us to be God's obedient children. Lord, we find that many of us have not been as obedient as we should. Some of us have not been keeping all of God's Ten Commandments, which is still binding on men. And you have said in your words that these commandments are our hearts, and we must teach them to our children. They must be our guide to direct us, oh Lord, to accept your commandments and to live by them. All of those who have not been keeping all of God's Ten Commandments right now, whether in this sanctuary or online, Lord, I pray that you will impress on their hearts to accept your commandments, because your commandments are not grievous. And that your commandments are still binding on men. You have said in your words, if you love me, keep my commandments. We pray that The relationship between parent and child will be strengthened. And we pray more than anything else that our relationship with you will be strong. Thank you, Lord, for hearing our prayers. Bless us as we go, and on Sabbath we look forward to another wonderful time in your presence. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Thank you, everyone, for being here with us tonight. God bless you as you go. The topic for Sabbath is Victory in the Valley, and we are going to have a grand baptism out here. If you are not yet baptized, even if you're online, the place to be is at Mandeville Church. Prepare and come. And I'm sure that the brethren here will be happy to receive you. So if you have not yet given your hearts to the Lord, Mandeville is a place where baptism is taking place on Sabbath. We look forward to seeing you. God bless you.
From our speaker on parenting the right way. I'm sure this message would have been a very interesting discussion for our parents and prospective parents as they prepare themselves for parenthood or better themselves for parenthood. I implore you to join us on Sabbath at 9:15 a.m. here at the Mandeville Seventh-day Adventist Church. If you don't know where we're located, that's 13A Caledonia Road, right here, right across from the hospital. You cannot miss the church. We start at 9:15 a.m. and I just invite you to join us as we continue our Let's Talk About Him series. I pray that you'll have a blessed week, and I invite our praise team to join us as we close with our theme song.